Welcome everybody. So to our opening session here regarding the content in this values-based innovation management track. We have two special speakers here today. On the one hand, Matthias Rauterberg. He's a professor for designing interactive systems at Eindhoven University of Technology. And he's a founder of the Industrial Design Department and Data Science Center at Eindhoven University. He's also part of the Technical Committee of Entertainment Computing of the International Federation for Information Processing. You can read his whole bio on the front page of the ISBIM conference. Among many other things, he supervised more than 20 PhDs, one of which I'm proud to be. So many years ago, I remember we were in Munich at a conference in HCI International, I think it was. And Matthias was so kind to have a look into my quite unprofessional and tiny poster and was willing to guide me through that thesis. So I'm very happy to have him here on board. On the other hand, we have Sven-Uwe Müller, program leader in cooperation with the private sector for the Deutsche Gesellschaft für Internationale Zusammenarbeit, GIZ. And he's the program leader for cooperation with the private sector and the head of the Lab of Tomorrow. That exemplifies in a very nice vein, I think, how you can come from a normative orientation towards actually working business models. And it's a project that we collaborated with my small consultancy UX Berlin for the last 2 years. So we're looking forward to his presentation. But first, I want to hand over the word to Matthias. And by the way, participants, if you want to receive the slides and a summary of our activities in the values-based innovation track, please post your email address into the chat and we'll copy it from there and share the materials with you.
Okay, then I will start. Yeah.
Yes, please.
Okay, thank you very much, Henning, to give me the opportunity to present part of the work we are doing in Eindhoven. The title is Human Value-Based Design, and I will introduce into this topic. First, I will give you an overview of the interaction paradigms, in particular in interactive systems as a special group of products. We are coming a long time ago from personal computing, and the notion was man-machine interaction. Then in the 80s, we started cooperative computing. Nowadays, we are talking about social computing with social media and all this technology available. And the upcoming, for me, particularly interesting topic is cultural computing. I will talk about a little bit later on that. First question is, what is culture? Culture is an integration pattern of human behavior that includes, among others, actions, attitudes, beliefs, norms, values, communications and language, institution of race, ethnic, religious and or social group, and many more. So what it is, it's a pretty complex topic, and there are very different ways how to deal with this complexity. First, I would like to address one of the interesting topics, depends in which domain you're operating, that culture has a kind of timing pattern on different layers. For example, in the fashion industry or software industry, they have a regularly annual cycle and they call it year layer, but some bigger companies, they have, or even nations or larger social groups, they operate on a century layer. And for religious systems and other more complex issues, they operate on the millennium layer. And what interested me as well was the universal layer of culture, which I'm not talking today. I'm talking about something more on the faster pace change upper layers. One of the interesting things which intrigued me was that most of the exchange and communication and the communication among society and citizens or members of a nation is what we consider conscious, something what we are doing right now, but the most exchange of cultural issues is done in unconscious manner. What also is interesting to see that any culture, any society or any company can be investigated or characterized by the products and services they are using. That's here in the middle of the here this part. And if you look at the products of the using, then you can also say something about the values. And the question is how to influence that. And there was one famous quote from Karl Marx. It is not the consciousness of man that determines their being, but on the contrary, the social being that determines their consciousness. And this is what we are trying to tap in. We have different design metaphors. This is a little bit complementary to my opening slides. The first one was a tool metaphor. Then most of the products we are using, like the computer in front of me, is it's a channel where the form and the content are separated. Form of my computer doesn't change independent of the content which goes through this channel. And the upcoming design challenges are active forms, and robots are just a humanized version of it, but can be any kind of active forms where the form and the content are designed together. What do we have? We have the mechanical style, the electronic style, which fits to the channel form. And the mechatronic style, this is can be split in active forms, connected forms, and given forms, and augmented reality and social robotics are the instantiation of these upcoming technologies which penetrates society. For the topic of today, there are two big questions. How to design product service systems based on human values. I'm not talking about values as such, but human values in particular. And the second question, how to convey these human values through the usage of these kind of design products and services. I have an answer to the first question, unfortunately not to the second one, although the second is much more intriguing. Okay, it happened to me 8 years ago that I got an email by a lady, Chadi Karandish from Iran. She got a PhD scholarship from the Ministry of Science, Research and Technology, and she was looking for a supervisor to do something about values. She's an industrial designer from her background, and then I composed a supervisory team. It's me, and I was lucky to get another colleague from my university, Martin Verkerk. He's a professor for philosophy, as a Reformation philosophy. One of my colleagues at my department, Stefan Wenzfein, he's a professor for constructive design research. And one of our associate professors, Matthias Funk, he has a computer science background. And the thesis value is the outcome of this project. And I will talk about this in particular. First is human values, how they intertwine and how they relate to everyday life experience and vice versa. Yeah, that's the underlying notion. How can we tap into this fabric of social life? The first step we did was to inventorize, also to get an overview over human values over the last more than 100 years. She investigated all the literature we could get into the human values from 1890 onwards. Here's just the upper part of these from 1970, and the lower part you can see in the thesis. She was investigating anthropology, philosophy, political science, psychology, sociology, and social psychology literature, which was addressing values. And then she compiled a list based on certain selection criteria. First, the outcome should be comprehensive. Also means cover all types of human values and different aspects I mentioned of human life, and also be capable of being used in different parts of design for various purposes and diverse topics. That's one of the interest. And the second one was well classified, also should be layered into different levels of meaningfulness. This framework, by clustering values into value groups, introduce different types of values, and also shorten the long value list. Because the values is a very fuzzy notion, because almost everything could have been captured under values, and the list was getting longer and longer. So the approach to design the value framework in the first instance was twofold. We compiled an existing value list of 63 values, which we identified from the literature. And then we had a theoretical approach and empirical approach. The theoretical approach was done through Martin Verkerk, my former introduced supervisory team colleague, based on the work of a Dutch former philosopher, Duyewert. He wrote a new critique of theoretical thoughts, in which he covered all the whole life and all things on through a value perspective. And next to it, we launched an international survey on human values, and then we gathered the lists of the outcome of the importance and other aspects I will introduce in the next slide. First, we got the ranking of the what are the most important values worldwide. Also, it's just one of the existing rankings. There are many more in the literature, and even some of the rankings are based on larger sample size, but for us it was good enough. We proposed 63 different values composed by the literature. And we got the respondents, and now you see the top one was healthiness, freedom, family security, honest, spiritual life, meaning in life, wisdom, and according to my understanding of the prime motivation of Shadi Karandish, the PhD student, is the spiritual life was one of the things she would like to put back on the agenda. And then the next part was for building a framework. We did a clustering of all this data, and then we had two types of cluster solution, a 7-cluster and a 9-cluster solution. And based on the theoretical input from Duyewert and the discussion with Martin Verkerk, we decided to go for the 9-cluster solution. Then we had to design for a tool how to bring the design the values we identified into the design process, and there was a theoretical research, empirical research. There's a timeline on top, and the final grouping, the 9 categories are on the bottom line. It's a personal development, respect for oneself, pleasure, status, meaningfulness, respect of others, ecology, justice, and carefulness. These are the 9 most comprehensive and cover all the human values we could find. This is the framework. Here we clustered them according to Duyewert into themes, basic beliefs, nature, self, and society on the next slide. And then you have the value groups, meaningfulness, ecology for nature, respect for oneself, personal development, and pleasure for self. And each of the value groups is characterized by 5 key values. That was an arbitrary choice, but we picked the most important one from our ranking list. And then if necessary, we added some extra values, but the 5 most important key values from our long list of 63 values went into the value group description. Here is for society, and then you see carefulness, justice, respect for others, and status as the value groups belonging to the topic society. You see also the key values, for example, carefulness, honest, kindness, loyal, forgiving, and helpful, and then extra values if necessary. Then Shadi was designing a tool where she try to find the right layout for describing the different value groups in a most attractive and meaningful manner. Here is just an alphabetic order, carefulness, ecology, justice. These are cards, as a value group cards, and each of the value group is described. For example, carefulness, the group is about the quality of caring for others. Then you have the key values here, and if necessary, the description of the additional values and related words. And this was done for all 9 value groups. And then she mapped them into what she called later the value wheel. She tried to put the different themes, basic beliefs, nature, self, and society on top, and then related underneath the value groups, and in each value group, the five value keys. This is the upper left corner from the final layout of this value key. You have here, I will introduce that later, additional cards. This is the value key, and then you have the value groups, respect for others, meaningfulness for the basic belief part, and carefulness for the society. And what's also interesting to see, you can put any interesting concept in the center of this value wheel, and you can express the importance of this particular value group towards the product or concept under investigation. And here is a kind of, you can cross mark from not important up to very important. You can just click here. And then we did an empirical study to validate the approach, experimental setting. We had participants from our first year design program, about 192 first year design students, which are split up in 48 project groups. And we we selected randomly six groups which were trained on this U-value tool, six groups which got the tool but no training, and four control group. And then we just let them design for the whole semester, and then we measured the outcome. The outcome was, according to the nine value groups, TG means the trained group, untrained group, they got access to the tool, but no training how to use them, and the control group. And this, you see the mean of the importance of the values by specified by the different groups in their final concepts. These differences are not significant, but the next one is when we measure the total value for each of the groups in the concept they proposed at the end of the semester, then we see a significant effect on the training group was significantly outperforming the control group in the usage of values proposed by the tool. The second measure we did was the diversity of the values, the numbers of different values they are using. This was also significant, and the trained group used much more different values than the control group. This is a tool. This is a value wheel in the middle where you, I just showed you the upper left part in the former slide. We have additional value words which can express the different values according to the things you would like to emphasize by using them. And we have 207 picture cards which describes person, situations, ideas, diagrams to in relation to the values which you can use in expressing your ideas, a kind of mood board, structured mood board approach. This was, you can put a person in the center, you can put a product in the center, you can put a situation, a mother drinking and driving, or a concept, and then you can express the idea, what kind of values you would like to attach or how to go further in this particular aspect. Here was, I asked Shadi to express her own value profile as a designer. She put herself into the picture, and then she used the picture cards and the situation and the words cards to express. And what you see here in front of you is the value profile of one person, like Shadi. It's a very intimate, yeah? And then you see what she cares about in her life as a human being. So it doesn't have to be used like that, but you can use it as well to this aspect. You can also put a concrete concept or product. It's an eco car in the center. And then you can also express the values which you associate with this particular product. we have three main conclusions. The U-value framework, which I introduced earlier. It's a comprehensive value framework to widen designers' view on human values because they give you an overview over 45 different key values plus extra value words. The U-value tool, a card-based design tool grounded on the value framework to facilitate using the framework in practice, and the U-value perspective, a design approach. So it's a kind of influencing and sneaking into the mind of the designer. It's a kind of priming, yeah, a designer to apply the underlying human values in the design process by thinking like that and reflecting on that and applying them in the design as such. Here are the references. You can download them from the link here. Yeah, and that's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention. There's an upcoming, yeah, this year, Culture and Computing Conference, which I'm the chair of. And if you want more about me, then just type in my family name into Google, and then you find my the link to my homepage, which I'm proud of. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Matthias. That's a very impressive research and project that you have shown there to us, and even with a wide-ranging historical perspective. Thank you very much for that. So we have two specific questions so far on that presentation. How did the conceptualization phase treat negative values such as fear, envy, anger, greediness? Was that part of the conceptualization, or was that a deliberate decision to not go into these directions?
That's a very good question. Actually, we had a very intensive discussion. I said, if you want to have a most comprehensive framework, we should include the evil part. Yeah? No, the idea is to design a tool which gives a positive direction. It's the notion of, you can, here, let's go back to this. This one. Most of them are non-evil, of course. I mean, yeah, but it covers all of them. I mean, spiritual life, you know, what the whole tool express is a good way of living. Let's phrase it like that. It's not to design for evilness or for, that's very clear. And that was also undebatable for Shadi, because her prime motivation, which I was, interesting to see at the beginning, was to put the spiritual life back on the agenda, because there are very famous value-based research in psychology by Schwartz, from an Australian colleague. The list of Schwartz excluded explicitly spiritual life, because that is too close to religion. And if you want to express a rigorous scientific approach, then you better touch not on religion, which we cover. I mean, meaningfulness is the value group which covers religious aspects. Mm-hmm. And this is the answer. It's very clear. No evil explicit expression of values are in this framework.
Yeah, so the evil tends to come by itself, even if you're not intending it sometimes. So you're focusing on, the rather positive values here with that.
That's the whole intention. I mean, we are not interested to design or help someone to design for something which could be harmful. Yeah? It should be... It strives the whole design process into a positive direction, meaning it should come, the outcome of the design process should be useful and acceptable, and whatever. Sustainability is part of it. It's the ecological cluster. Yeah, you can see here ecology, and then word of peace, unity with nature. That would be sustainability. Protecting the environment would be aspect of sustainability. A word of beauty and waste avoidance. Yeah, these are the key values coming from the ranking.
Right. We have another question asking, when you said the students were trained, how was that meant? So how they used the values? Yeah. How was it measured? Did you do a survey, or did they produce design solutions that were evaluated by your team?
That was the let me we are running, that's part of our design program in Eindhoven. We are training our bachelor students to become industrial designers, and the first year they get a big project that's called Project One for design, the first design challenge they're supposed, and we have here, in this particular semester, we had 192 first year design students. And for the training group, Shadi and two others, they trained the student, this group of students, or five or six students, a project group, how to use the tool, how to use the words, picture cards, and how to use the wheel, and you can put in the center, you can put anything almost, a person, a concept, an idea, or a real product, you can evaluate the product. We didn't do so to organizations or part of organization, probably you could do that as well, but this is speculative. And the trained student group, they got an intensive workshop, two or three workshops, how to use them at the beginning of the semester. And then they had to run the project anyhow, the design project. That was, if they had questions, they could come back. What we found out was later that one of the control group, they discovered the tool and they used it as well. So we had to take them out of the control group for the statistical analysis. Yeah? Because it was a certain type of attractiveness to them. It was not intended, but the untrained group, they got the tool, but no further instruction how to use them.
All right, great.
Yeah.
We have a couple of more questions coming up, and I'm afraid we cannot go into all of them, but I would like to take one more because they're very specific on your work, I think. So one is how you would differentiate between values, needs, and emotions. Also the question and how far these values are independent from one another.
They are not. I mean, was part of my earlier comments here. Yeah. For example, in the cluster analysis, we could find that values belong to each other. So we do not touch on emotions. That's a consequence of the usage of a product or service or product service system. Yeah. But this is in a kind of user experience by using them. So the values, the underlying values in the design process should convey in the best sense a certain type of user experience. And even better, but we have no evidence for that. Yeah? That was a question or a scientific claim, but no evidence yet whether we can convey the original values which went into the design of the product service system by conveying this meaning, these values through the usage later on of the design product service system, independent of the intentions of the designer. That's a very for me, challenging and not answered question yet, how to do so.
And do you go into the difference to needs? Because I guess part of the background for that question is that in customer research, oftentimes it's the question about customer needs that should inspire the whole innovation and ideation process.
Need analysis is something else. There are special tools and techniques for that part. We were trying to focus on values, and in the sense of positive, to give a positive direction, to express certain design concept from a value perspective. That was the prime target and to focus on that. Although if you see here even the key values, which are not on the same level of abstraction. That's one of the difficulties to deal with values, because values have an inflationary use. I mean, value-based design, what we found first was just money-driven. That's what you find on internet. No? But that was not what we are interested in. Although wealth here and status, if you go to status and wealth, material possession and money comes back. It's still covered, and we claim it's the most comprehensive framework.
Yeah.
That's what we can claim compared to all the other value lists or whatever value frameworks on the market.
All right, great. Yes, okay. That's part of our motivation also, differentiate from this very narrow economic view on these issues. Very last question, the name of the tool, does it have?
U-Value, human value.
Human value.
Yeah, that was part of the, U-Value, the name U-Value, human value. Yeah.
Great.
But you can download it even somewhere from, come back to me if you want to get access to, but
the value tool is big. Yeah, I think some of the participants would want to, so we'll make sure we include that in the email we send you with some of the materials we're collecting here.
Yeah, you can download at least the PhD from Shadi, and then you can use the content from, here, this booklet, it can be downloaded for free, and all the things, including the scientific part, is included in this booklet. 300 pages with all the, not all the words and picture cards are included, but there are extra links where you can download that part as well.
Great. Okay. Yeah, we look forward to reading that. So let's move on to Sven-Uwe Müller and GIZ and the Lab of Tomorrow, because we're kind of radically shifting perspectives here over to the SDGs and how you can grow your own business out of those. Sven, may I pass you the word?
Thanks, Henning, and thanks, Matthias, for this very interesting presentation. It makes me very humble, and I don't know whether values, as I use it in this framework of my presentation, is still really the right word for it. Let's see, to be discussed. Can you see my presentation? Is it online now?
Yes, very well.
Should be. Okay, very good. So I work for GIZ, the German International Corporation Company. We are a German public benefit federal enterprise, so owned by the German government. We work in the field of international cooperation, focus on capacity development for sustainable development in all its dimension, on the individual level, institutional, regulatory, societal level. And we are a quite big company with around 1,500 projects worldwide in 120 countries. Our main clients are the German ministries, but also others like foundations, like multilateral organizations, the EU and the UN agencies, but also companies. And I myself lead the Lab of Tomorrow and some other projects in the field of cooperation with the private sector. So the companies are very dear to us. And the approach of the Lab of Tomorrow is really to focus on the SDGs. These are our general framework of what we want to achieve. We focus on the situation in, of developing and emerging countries. And we use design thinking, use a user-centric, multi-stakeholder open innovation process to generate business models. And these business models then should be tailored to address really the local challenges. We always do such a Lab of Tomorrow process in a very specific location and really try to focus on those very specific challenges in that specific country. And we envision to have then as an outcome of this process, startups or joint ventures, so business entities which have implemented and brought to success a business model with products or services who actually contribute to achieving the SDGs. So to put it in one phrase, it's really about harnessing the power of innovation of the private sector for achieving the SDGs. And that's the main purpose of this process. The Lab of Tomorrow started around 5 years ago and has already implemented several of the processes. And I will show you now the general concept of the process and then also give you some examples of the outcomes of this process. So to go deeper into the process, altogether, it's quite a long process. It can be more than a year. Usually, what people see most is our innovation workshop. So the design thinking innovation sprint, which is here in phase number two, the innovation phase. But that's only really the tip of the iceberg. to prepare this, we have a quite long phase of 3 to 4 months to really understand what we want to address, understand, first of all, select a challenge, define it to make it as concrete as possible, conduct research to really understand it in all its dimensions. And then that's also a very important part, to really get the right partners and participants on board. And then we have this innovation sprint, which is 3 to 5 days. There we come together in small groups, groups up to 6 people. And each group addresses a separate sub-challenge. So we have a kind of architecture of a general challenge. I will show you more of the challenges on the next slides, and break these down then in very specific sub-challenges. And then every small group comes up with an innovative idea to address the specific sub-challenges with a business model. And then if they feel comfortable and think that their business model is really worth to be developed and to be implemented, then they prepare for the incubation phase, and we support them then also in business design and also in piloting of the business model. So this is an overview of the 9 challenges we have implemented so far. So we have 9 Lab of Tomorrow processes, the whole process as you saw it on the last slide. The last one I participated was the LOT8 in Thailand, where we addressed decreasing plastic waste. And then, just to give you an idea, that's the main challenge. And we break it down then in sub-challenges like increasing the usage of recycled material, increasing recycling, avoiding waste in wet markets, avoiding waste in shopping centers, promoting multi-use systems, and so on. So these are then the kind of very specific sub-challenge on which the groups work there. And to give you an idea of the outcome of such a Lab of Tomorrow process, I want to focus on the LOT3 Kenya, where it is about access to medicines and diagnostics. So, to understand the challenge, in Kenya and in most of the parts of Africa, the small pharmacies, the small drug shops are really the point of first primary healthcare. So they provide the biggest part of healthcare. If someone is ill, he goes to a pharmacy or a small drug shop. And if he doesn't get the right medicine there, or if the medicine is overpriced, or if it's not of good quality, or if it's fake medicine, then this creates a very big problem, of course. So that was the challenge, really to improve the access to medicines and diagnostics for the people. And these small pharmacies and drug shops, of course, they struggle with a very fragmented landscape. They have supply chains where they don't have any control upon. And this is all over a very intransparent setting. So patients have to pay more for essential medicine. They often can't really afford the high impact, high quality medicine. The providers, the drug shops or pharmacies have no idea how to forecast demand, have very limited working capital, have also very limited knowledge of the supply chain. So this they wanted to address in this innovation challenge. And the innovative idea one group came up with, so there were several groups, but I focus now on one, was medicine on demand. And they established a venture. It's now called MeisherMeds. You also find it when you Google. And it's a digital tool that helps to manage the sales and inventory of these small drug shops and pharmacies, and really provide quality medication. And as it is more linked and more transparent, it can also provide discounts, and it can even provide subsidies to patients. If there are sponsors who want to sponsor a certain type of medicine for a certain group, you can do this in a very transparent way now, because it is a complete online solution. So you have a digital pharmacy network linked by the point of service, the point of sale. So you have the possibility to give reimbursements, and you also have, as it is a fully online solution, also a much better overview about what you have sold, in which time frame. So it gives you an opportunity to restock and provide high quality and affordability. Here you see some screenshots of this solution. So it's really it provides a solution for these small pharmacies, and it also provides a solution for the patient. As you see in number two, they can get reimbursements if, for example, there are some pharma firms which want to provide special offers to special target groups, or if there's a program of the government or of an NGO to help certain patients in Kenya. The incubation phase of this is finished. It is already an established company now, and we are very proud that this is so successful that it also managed to attract a considerable investment. So USAID invested $1.5 million into this solution, and also the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation invested another $1.5 million. Altogether, now the impact is also quite impressive. It has reached by now more than 1 million patients in Kenya, and reimbursed medication costs for more than 20,000 people already in this year. And as it is so successful, they are thinking about expanding operations now to Tanzania and Uganda. So this is an example of one specific venture, but we have completed altogether 9 of these different Lab of Tomorrow processes. You have seen them, some in Kenya, some in Thailand, Mexico, Egypt, and so on. And altogether, we had around 250 participating organizations and companies involved in these 9 processes, 58 business ideas generated, and then 29 of them really developed to a full-fledged business model. And of those 29, 11 now are already established as companies, as ventures in operation. And these ventures attracted altogether 5 million euros of third-party investment now. So what is critical for this Lab of Tomorrow? I mentioned it on the third slide. In a way, it's really about harnessing the innovative capabilities of the private sector. And we saw this when we started 5 years ago and at that moment it was still a quite new idea. Now it has become much more mainstream. I would say there were many similar endeavors from other development agencies. But at that time, it was really thinking outside of the box of traditional development cooperation, and really bringing in the private sector with its creativity, and bringing in the private sector with its own interest to make it sustainable, also from the economic sense, but also sustainable in the social and environmental sense. And yeah, this needs a good setup. So we really need good and committed participants who have this entrepreneurial mindset. We need a good network of partners, because once such a business idea is developed, it has to be handed over in an ecosystem where it can grow. So this network of accelerators and investors is also very important. And as I also said when I pointed out the process, it all starts with an in-depth understanding of the challenge. And we also had our own learning curve in these 9 labs. Actually, there were some, for example, social standards for garment manufacturers in Cambodia, which was a very early lab of tomorrow, where I would say nowadays it might have been better to think about regulation to address this. So it's also important that you select the right challenges where you have a space for the private sector to develop a solution, where there is rather a lack of regulation, it might not work that good. And then user centricity, yeah, of course, that's the whole design thinking approach. And that's really very important and crucial. And yeah, it's also the history of those ventures who were successful really shows us that those who really put the user experience, the user benefit into focus are the most successful ones. And of course, you also need local support because we are a small team here in Berlin of actually 5 people. And if we want to implement these innovation processes, which take more than a year, as you have seen, we need a reliable local partner. And we mostly until now find them in the form of GIZ projects, which are active in that specific country. But that's not a must. If we find other partners who want to team up with us and who are present on the ground in the country, it's also a very good way to go forward. So to end with an appeal to become our partner, I said partners are crucial. I said that this whole network of partnership is really also a key success factor for nurturing these early ideas, these early business models, to full-fledged ventures, which then can be successful on the market. So yeah, we are always looking for institutions and experts who are active in the field of business development, innovation management, or entrepreneurs who are really interested in sustainability, in co-creating, who are open for co-creating, and all kind of facilitators, accelerators, and especially also investors who can support our ventures. This was a short introduction into our Lab of Tomorrow. If you have further questions, don't hesitate to contact us. You also find us on the web. And you also have my email address here, and don't hesitate to write me an email. We are happy to provide more information. That's it for the moment, and looking forward to your questions.
I may add one little thing. So we came together working on a kind of toolbox of methods together to support these kind of processes. And since you're a public funded institutions, these will be made available to the public, to everyone, quite soon. So make sure you look out for the handbook on the Lab of Tomorrow website coming up sometime soon. Pasted the web address also into the chat together with the different links to the SIG. And yeah, thank you very, very much for this also very great presentation. And maybe Matthias, if you're still there. So yeah, I wouldn't be shy or too modest about what you're doing. I think it's just a very, these are quite different approaches, obviously, kind of illustrating the range of activities that we want to bring together. I think also in this special interest group, ranging from basic research and design and psychology on the one hand to its application on really global scale projects, right? From product design to business model design, so to say. And what I found impressive on this Lab of Tomorrow approach is especially the fact, and that's unlike what we see in many organizations today, that these values, so to say, formalized as these SDG, do not only provide a heuristic to start thinking about solutions, they do not only integrate diverse stakeholders into the process and provide a direction for them throughout the process, but that you are actually combining this with the continuous impact management, yeah, that you are really paying close attention if these initial goals are already also met throughout the different intermediary steps of the prototypes up to the working business model out in the field, then in the end. And I think that's a very valuable perspective, and I hope we see more of these kind of approaches and activities coming up also in for-profit initiatives. Great. So we have still here almost 34 participants here in the line. Unfortunately, that was mentioned in the previous session, this webinar format doesn't allow us to see who's all in here. I think we have some additional questions here coming up. One is, do you always have some entrepreneur back, or do you find the people who take on the ideas?
Yeah, that's...
So yeah, I guess this is how you identify the people in the partner countries and how you manage the matchmaking, so to say, right?
Yeah, we try in these small design thinking groups, which have at maximum 6 colleagues, well, sometimes also 8, we try to have at least half of the colleagues in that group coming from enterprises. We bring in established enterprises, so it, the outcome of such a process can also be a new venture in an established firm. But recently we also thought about, and because we have seen it's also a bit difficult for colleagues coming from an established enterprise and just taking 1 week off for this innovation workshop to really follow up and to really make it their thing and to really invest considerable time to develop a new business model. So this is not something which is very easy for them. So right now we are also in contact with business schools and the entrepreneurial programs of a lot of universities to find young colleagues from the universities with an entrepreneurial spirit who are at the beginning of their career and also have the time to invest in such. So it depends. So it's at the moment a mixture, but your question points to the very key point, which we also want to improve. We really want to get those people on board who have the spirit and the time and the focus and the determination to develop a full-fledged business solution and make it successful on the market. Mm-hmm. If I may address also the next question of Maria, sure. How do you initially identify and define the challenges and the locations that will be in focus? Yeah, it's a mixed process. We have the global network of GIZ with 120 countries and 1,500 projects. So we also call out for proposals in that network. We recently also reached out to other development agencies from neighboring countries who are also interested in this approach. So from there, we might also develop now further challenges. We need ownership on the ground, and that's very important. And for us, it's the easiest way is still to rely on the GIZ, network. But for example, now we are thinking about a challenge where we cooperate very closely with an NGO, and the GIZ structures on the ground are not that strong. So it's more the NGO which then takes the lead in providing the access to the local network. Because in many cases, you need the access not only to tap to the industry and the entrepreneurs and the design thinking community, you also need it to tap to the politicians, because we really want to make it a multi-stakeholder process. And so politics, society, NGOs, and business should come together. That's really it's a key feature of our design thinking process here in the Lab of Tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Great. Okay, we have a question. Do companies pay for your services? As far as I know, they do not yet, at least.
Yeah, right. At the moment, well, it's we thought that we should slowly move to a model where they should also pay. For the time being, the last processes, I think, were also more processes where we refined the model and still learned also to optimize our system and our processes. But I think it's mature now, and it could be that we also charge for the processes.
Okay.
But they invest their time. I mean, that's also quite a considerable investment.
Yeah. So we also have the questions how students can collaborate, but I'm happy to make the contact to you and to forward such ideas by Tatiana here. So as a last question before we're ending, unfortunately, you have to end the session. Matthias, do you see a place in such a process for these kinds of tools that you are developing? And when do you see how you could benefit with Matthias and his PhD student?
First, Shadi finished her PhD 2 years ago, so she is an independent researcher. Yeah, she was my PhD student, but yes. Nevertheless, she is now, she has a position at the industrial design department at the University in Tehran in Iran.
Mm-hmm.
She is very, a very honest person. I mean, probably one of the most honest person I ever met in my life. I appreciated that very much and very serious. The idea was to inspire people and to give them a tool also to think in different, in diverse values beyond the predetermination. Look, if you go back to my presentation, she expressed her own value system through her own tool. Yeah, and everybody can do so. I didn't dare to express my own value system because I'm not sure what might come out of that part. But nevertheless, you can do so, and you can see what are the important values for your customers if they express their own value profiles through the tool. And then you could also identify potential needs based on that, because the value drives their lifestyle, and the lifestyle is what ends up in the needs of action taken to maintain a certain lifestyle.
Hmm. Yeah, I found it very interesting. I also studied philosophy, so this resonated very much with me. This human value approach. I And when we start our innovation workshop and we start the design thinking process, then it's always very important that the people get to know each other. And I think it could be a very good starter to use this concept for such a small design thinking group to really start a conversation of yeah. the values yeah, which
that's true.
Motivate the people yeah. and
inspires them, because the picture cards, they have people, they have as a prominent, well-known people for certain value groups, situations, and even the products on the market. Yeah, and that helps people to stimulate and to start a discussion if you want to have a discussion on values. Yeah? So that's one of the potential usage of these kind of tools. Yeah.
Mm. Oh, and if I think of our last design thinking process, the Lab of Tomorrow in Thailand on plastic waste, we also, when we kicked off the whole process, it's really very important that, especially if it's a multi-stakeholder and multicultural group, to make more explicit from where the people come and what's important for them. And this is a very good framework for that.
Because actually, most of the values, very much true. It's the most comprehensive value framework we developed, particularly for this purpose. We don't know yet whether it is applicable to all cultures on Earth. There's a strong Western bias based on the literature processed. But what my best guess is that the different cultures can be expressed in this value framework, but the importance of certain values might deviate or might vary among cultures. But I can't see any values which are not addressed. That's what the strong part of this comprehensive framework is. Yeah. And then it helps to make certain things explicit if you are challenged to express your own value profile by the tool, as Shadi did. I mean, it was, if you have a closer look, she started, I'm a female and I want to become a woman. I want to have a family. And then it developed because she also in her animation and the presentation, she also started with the first thing which are most important to her. And then you see later on which other values came next.